Are you sure about this, recovering addicts in the conditional cash transfer program?
We had a preliminary discussion with the representatives of DSWD, and they said that they will accommodate it, because it's always a problem that recovering drug addicts who came from rehabilitation centers who are poor cannot sustain their recovery process because of lack of funds.
I see the merit of this. Obviously, they don't have the money, but sometimes when you're given that much, not even that much money, but if you have that money to spend freely, it could also be a source of temptation. I mean, this is just my view, especially how do you certify that the person has really been rehabilitated and should be deserving of such a support from the CCT?
That's true, Your Honor, but the process of rehabilitation is, even after graduating from the rehabilitation facility, has to attend to some aftercare activities, so that in the aftercare program, he is not given such assistance, he may not be able to present himself to the counselor that is monitoring his case.
Okay, so, that's perfect. At least if he can be monitored and he can be tested regularly, the same way a CCT requires a family to actually send their kids to school regularly and to health centers, then this will be. But you really have to have safeguards because of the nature of the program, which is to actually give cash.
That's true, Your Honor. That's why closely coordinating with the SWD is needed, so that indeed the money cannot just be given and for them to use for some other purpose, but rather, for example, because even in the rehabilitation process, even after coming out of the rehabilitation centers, he has to have some maintenance medicine, for example, some vitamins, and even his trips to and from the counselor that he was monitoring him needs a little money.
So, thank you, Sec. I'm sorry to interrupt. You can proceed now.
Thank you very much, Your Honor. For the seventh program trust, we hope to continue supporting the integration of drug abuse prevention in the primary health care advocacy campaigns being undertaken by DOH. Then produce more audiovisual public service announcements and information materials on drug abuse prevention to further broaden stakeholders' awareness. We have very limited audiovisual materials for distribution, since producing these materials cost a lot of money. So tied up with the PIA and some government agencies, we try to request some assistance for the production of this audiovisual.
Secretary, I have a quick question. You were talking about your promoting this advocacy, anti-drug advocacy. Isn't it included already in the curriculum in schools? Don't you have any design program that teachers can integrate in their syllabus?
Actually, Your Honor, Mr. Chairman, DepEd has this, and DDB is in support. And definitely it's a requirement, and it's placed in the law that it should be part of the curriculum. However, because of, shall we say, lack of time, they only allow a little fraction of the hour for this purpose.
So yours is reinforcement of the program, but it's actually integrated in the curriculum.
Yes, okay.
Thank you.
For the ninth program trust, we want to expand the database on drug driving and drug-related crimes. Very recently, there was a law that was passed where driving under the influence of substances is punishable. It's just too bad that we have very, very little data on drug driving or driving under the influence of drugs. We hope to maintain a wider database so that this can be used as basis for policy.
How do you propose that we maintain that? Who will you coordinate with? Local law enforcement?
Actually, we started this by asking into a meeting law enforcement agencies that handle suspects or even criminals. For example, the Bureau of Correction, we tried to ask them for some data on their holdings, where an inmate who has been charged and found guilty may have some connection with some drugs, for example, if he committed a crime and he was under the state of drugs when he committed this. This is based on record in the Bureau, and we try to collect those information. We also requested other law enforcement units to give us some data on, for example, even suspects while they are undergoing investigation, if they display some manifestation of drug use, can be taken note of, and this can be part of the statistics. Although we're not going to say that positively they are drug suspects, but rather supposedly suspicious to have used drugs before they committed the crime. And other probable data that we can gather so that we can really put up a database on this, because
is this part of your budget now, putting up this database or in your program?
It's included in the program, but sad to say that we have not gotten any specific budget for this program, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you.
Then the last is continued evaluation of existing anti-drug abuse program to determine the relevance and effectiveness. We have some programs running, but we still want to find out if this has been running smoothly or effectively, so that enhancements can be done in case we found them very ineffective anymore, or we have outlived its usefulness. For the program trust, we are asking for this proposed budget. In 2013, the total budget of the DB was 104,946,000 for the general fund and 77,000,000 for special fund, or the special fund 151, which comes from the contribution of PCSO and PAGCOR, Philippine Racing Commission, and so forth. For 2014, DDB is requesting the budget of 106,374,000 for general fund and 77 for special fund. And the breakdown of this budget is as shown on the screen. For general administration and support, we have 39,411,000 broken down as for personal services, we have 22,163,000. For MOOE, 17,248,000. Then for support operations, 10,494,000 broken down for PS, 6.9 million, MOOE, 2.390 million, and for capital outlay, 1.2 million. For operations, this is to fund the programs and activities being undertaken. We're asking for 52,530,000, broken down for PS 14.3, for MOE 38.2, and that's it for the whole breakdown of the budget for orders.
Sir, Mr. Chair, good question. You know what they said for the rehabilitation, or to actually beat the drug problem, there's the actual step. You have preventive education, which I heard you present. You have the rehabilitation, which you also mentioned in coordination, hopefully later on with the SWD. But there's also livelihood programs or alternative development. So I'd like to know if you have any particular alternative development programs now in place, and the success rate of this, and how much are you allotting for this? Because it was mentioned before, alternative employment for these people that will actually lose their jobs.
Actually, Your Honor, we targeted the Cordillera region, particularly Benguet province, considering that in the past reports, this has been found to have produced the majority amount of marijuana being cultivated in the Philippines. This is in the province of Benguet, particularly Tibungan, Kapangan, Bacon.
But it's been ongoing for many years now, right? Do you have anything new or have you been reinforcing it? This is the only example that we can cite for now?
While we have, we piloted the silk production, Your Honors, it's just so bad that we don't actually have fund allotted for alternative development. What we did before, when we funded these activities in the three municipalities of Benguet, was from what we have been able to save. So at the moment, while they are continuing this, they're asking for additional support, we try to find out if we have some savings that can be derived and support it. In fact, the intention then was put it in place, then when we see the sort of the degree of success that it's going to accomplish, turn it over to DA. In fact, we invited the Department of Agriculture, except that I think they were too busy during that time, while they sent a representative to look into how it was implemented in Bacon, Kibungan, in Kapangan. But after that, they did not.
How's the silk business going? Are they able to produce still and make decent income out of it?
Together with the Fiber Industry Development Authority, they train the families, no? Where marijuana has been seen to be cultivated, and there were cooperatives formed so that a family which is a recipient of some assistance would put up a what they call a rearing house, where they kumbaga po pinipisa yung
hindi, okay lang po yung process, but are they still making money out of this?
We assume they are, but they're very marginal, because they've been asking for additional support. Because, for example, a family can take charge of about two or three rearing houses, but because of lack of funds, no funds at all, they're limited to just one. I think the total amount that was given to them were only good for about 50 rearing houses.
Okay, thank you. Please proceed if you have any more. I have no questions.
That's the summary of the budget that we have, Mr. Chairman. We are hoping that this budget will be accepted and approved, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much, Ron.
Thank you, sir. Just a few questions. One, what is the breakdown of your 1.2 million capital outlay?
Actually, this is to replace the five-year-old vehicle, Innova, that was funded about 5 or 6 years ago, Mr. Chairman.
Second, sir, when you submitted to the committee the breakdown of your projects under chargeable, under special fund 151, the 50 million, the 19.3, as well as the 7.7 million.
We can, Your Honor, if...
Have you submitted that, sir? Yes. Third, sir, not for this budget cycle, but next budget cycle, the committee will hold you to task with respect to COA observations, findings, and recommendations, whether it is with respect to your term or your predecessor's term. We refuse to simply take it sitting down and let it be swept under the rug simply because your predecessor committed it. Pag sinabi po namin tuldukan, sana sila tayo magkita-kita, either kasuhan nyo na yung dapat kasuhan, question it before COA and bank, file a case before the courts to question the COA finding if you disagree with it. But definitely, the letters cannot keep on... hindi po pwedeng palitan na naman ang palitan ng sulat sa pagitan ng AHENSA at NATOA. Not only your agency, sir, but all agencies will do this.
We'll do that, Your Honor.
Please do, sir. Second, you mentioned livelihood. You're only talking about marijuana. What about other drugs proliferating in the Philippines? Correct me if I'm wrong. Hindi naman yata uso marijuana ngayon eh.
Still, with your respect, Your Honor, marijuana is still number two among the substance being abused.
Hindi na uso. Pag number two, hindi na uso yun. Kaya number two na siya eh. Yung one ng uso eh. Ano ba yung one ngayon?
Shabu.
Methamphetamine hydrochloride or shabu.
Which is shabu. Anong alternative livelihood sa shabu? Hindi niyo kaya bigyan ng hanap buhay sa laki ng kita niya. Hindi yan tulad ng tatanim.
And that's true, Your Honor.
There's no such alternative livelihood proposal for shabu, right? Or dealers in shabu.
Yeah, you know, that's why you know, we're targeting at least marijuana, which we still see that somehow it's proliferating in the whole country, Mr. Chairman.
Next, sir, you said drug driving, except for a blood test. How do you find out? I'm one of the authors of the DUI bill. May breath analyzer, merong hawakan mo yung ilong mo, maglakad ka ng diretso. How do you test for drugs, except through a blood test, ha?
Your Honor, the one you mentioned, the sobriety test for alcohol. But for drug driving, it's still by urine, Your Honor, principally. And if it's found positive, screening positive, the same specimen is tested through the GCMS machine. And if it's found positive again, that is the time that we can pronounce that he is indeed user of drug.
And you have data on what the tolerable levels are, or as long as you are taking drugs, that's it?
Mr. Chairman, the Department of Health has a level that is being observed. This is based on international standards, so that if the testing gives a reading that...
Sir?
Yes, Your Honor.
If you're taking marijuana, kahit na maliit pa yun, it's illegal, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
So you mean to tell me, if you're taking marijuana, it has to reach a certain level before you can be penalized for drug driving?
Not necessarily in that context, Mr. Chairman, Your Honor. It's just that the confirmatory test is used so that false positives can be removed from the record. Of course, if one is taking marijuana, if there's a finding of marijuana, that is already an indication.
But in relation to driving, at least guilty siya sa marijuana user siya, pero in relation to driving, you think there's a level of usage before you're not allowed to drive if you're taking marijuana?
If it's positive for drug,
definitely. Period, right? Tapos na yan?
Yes, Your Honor.
Kahit gaano karami pa yun sa ihi niya o sa dunya?
Yeah, that's true, Your Honor. But again, as required by the law, there should be, for drug testing, there should be a confirmatory test to be done.
Yes, sir. Do you have data on, sabi niyo, number one ang shabu, number two ang marijuana, number three?
Inhalants, Your Honor. What we term as contact cements. Yeah, rugby, vulcasil.
Wala pang cocaine?
Cocaine is a little far down, Your Honor.
Really, sir? For the record, sir, ilan ba addicts sa Pilipinas?
The estimate for the 2008 household survey was 1.7. We are about to complete the 2012 survey, and there is a slight decrease showing...
So the data, our basis is household survey?
Yes, Your Honor.
May kilala ko ba kayong umaamin na nagdodroga?
It's an estimate, Your Honor, that we follow. The usual survey that being conducted by SWS.
Sir, pag tinanong niyo ako sinong boboto, iba naman yun sa nagdodroga ka ba?
That's true, Your Honor, but somehow mayroong plus and minus dun sa proseso. And it's following a scientific way of estimating. Just like poll surveys, we follow the same...
Sir, okay lang ako dun eh. Okay lang ako dun sa ibang surveys. I'm a believer in surveys. I follow surveys, I do surveys. I do polling on almost everything. But on something illegal, how do you expect the respondent to admit it? Or to even say? How do you even phrase the question? Tumitira ka ba? Di ba?
That's true, Your Honor.
I cannot imagine a situation wherein the person will actually admit to the commission of a crime. Like murder, may stats ang police, ilan ba pinatay? Robbery, may stats ang police, ilan ba pinatay? I would presume that a basis would be apprehension, if any, but usage, the only way we can determine it is a survey?
Yeah, actually, Your Honor, we have several sources, but we feel that, for example, if we base it only on those submit for treatment and rehabilitation, we will not get the entire picture because not everybody who uses drugs could submit himself to treatment and rehab. For example, there are about 10,000 bed capacities for all the government and private rehab facility. But sad to say that about 2,000 plus only submitted themselves for
rehab.
Yes, and even for those if we visit an arrested suspects, not all suspects are arrested. So again, we may not be able to base it on a.
Sir, I don't blame you. I just sympathize with you. Empathize with you because I really don't know how we can get the data on the number of users in the country. If the household survey is the basis, I don't know how reliable that is.
It is.
I don't know. How do they do it in other countries, sir?
Actually, Mr. Chairman, with modesty aside, we were one of the countries cited for doing the household survey. Other countries, no offense to them, they're just submitting what they want to submit. For example, one country is submitting a population of a billion, submitting only the number of drug users or drug users arrested as their statistics. And some submitted only those submitted for treatment and rehab.
But sir, if they cited us, it means we're the only one doing it.
Not really, Mr. Chairman.
One of the few doing it. If everybody's doing it, there's no reason to cite us.
The United Nations Office for Drugs and Crime are convincing the countries to follow the household survey.
Really?
Yes, Your Honor.
That's the best practices now?
Yes, Your Honor.
Because do you have a copy of the questionnaire, sir? I'm just interested. Again, I'm a student of survey, sir. I'm very interested.
We can provide.
I need to submit that to us, sir. Gusto ko lang malaman kung paano nila tinatanong at paano mapapaamin yung taong. Kung paano na paamin. 1,200, 1,800 respondent.
Actually, Mr.
1.4 million, that's about 1%. So at 1,800, about 18 people admitted to using drugs.
Mr. Chairman, actually, it's not only 1,200, but 10,000 respondents.
About 10,000 respondents?
Then, from all over the country.
Then you're talking 1,000 of them admitted that they're using? Again. Anyway, I want to see the question, sir. Yuris na ako ang panel. SWS, but hindi, NHGS yan.
Your Honors, we tied up with the Philippine Normal University Research Center, DDB, and the ALG, and we conducted the survey.
Tignan na lang mo namin, sir.
Yes, Your Honor.
Again, I don't profess to be an expert. I'm just curious and I want to learn.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Anything else? Grace? Done?
Mr. Chair, I move that the DDB budget be submitted to plenary for approval.
So moved. There be no objection. Proposed budget of the DDB for 2014 is hereby submitted to plenary for deliberation and approval. Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining us, Ms. Samento.
Thank you very much, Your Honor.